container's full. Today's scripture is taken from Matthew chapter 5, verses 38 through 42, and that's part of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. So listen for Jesus' words. You have heard it said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist an evildoer. But if anyone strikes you on the right cheek, turn the other also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your coat, give him your cloak as well. And if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go also the second mile. Give to everyone who begs from you, and do not refuse anyone who wants to borrow from you. This is the word of God for all the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you for taking those candies, because when Nate grabbed 8 of them, I did not want to be responsible for 8. Although he tried to do that in service, not last Sunday, but the Sunday before. Just kept shoving them in his pockets, hoping no one would notice. I noticed. Okay, so before I pray, I wanted to tell you guys about a spiritual practice that I do. I've mentioned this before, but every time before I pray, I take a deep breath in, and I'm breathing in the Holy Spirit. And so if you ever hear me praying and I do that, I wanted you to know that that's what was happening, and I invite you to do that with me. So will you pray with me? Good and gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be pleasing to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So last Thursday was open house for the area elementary schools, and both of my kids are in elementary school, so that meant that in the evening we were loading up to go to the open house, and it was sprinkling outside, so my kids had their hoodies on, and my husband, Kevin, was messing around with our youngest, taking his hood off so that his hair would get wet, and then he'd put it back on and he'd take it off. Well, my oldest son, Nate, saw that they were doing this and thought they were playing a different game, and so he runs up to his dad and whomps him on the top of the head. Because apparently there's a game where you try and touch the top of the head of someone, and that's what Nate was doing. He just did so very enthusiastically. And Kevin stopped walking and turned to Nate, and Nate knew immediately that that had not been the right decision. And before Kev could even say a word, Nate apologized and said, "For retribution, Dad, you should hit me upside the head." And Kevin said, "I am not going to do that, son. It is not eye for an eye. I just want you to think before you act." And that's when I piped in. I said, "Y'all know this is making the sermon on Sunday, just so you know." Perks of being married to, the child of, or even in the vicinity of a pastor. Sorry, not sorry, guys. So on Ash Wednesday, we began our Lenten sermon series where we're focusing on 9 of the revolutionary teachings of Jesus. And so far, we've focused on simple living, compassionate action, inclusive hospitality, extravagant forgiveness, and then our focus today is on lavish generosity. Now, when we think of generosity, most of us think of money, honestly. And while we definitely want to continue to give monetary resources, the focus this morning is going to be more on an all-encompassing of generosity. So being generous with our physical resources, yes, but also with our time, our presence, our praise, our love, and our joy. So there's a famous quote that's attributed to John Wesley, and I went down a little bit of a rabbit hole on the Google, because there's controversy as to whether or not he actually said this or wrote this or whatever. No matter what, it is right in line with his teachings, and as I say it, a lot of you are going to know what I'm talking about. It's do all the good that you can, by all the means that you can, in all the ways that you can, in all the places that you can, in all the times that you can, to all the people that you can, for as long as you ever can. So that is definitely lavish generosity. Wesley got the message. The question is, do we? So our scripture today, thank you, Kim, wherever you went. Oh, there you are. She's right there for sharing God's word with us. It comes from the Sermon on the Mount. So early in Jesus' ministry, people started following him. And it got to the point where he just sat down and started teaching. And there are three chapters in the book of Matthew that are full of his teachings from that time. And this scripture comes from the rare moment when Jesus isn't talking in parable, isn't answering a question with a question. He just sits down and he's laying it all out. And in the scripture that we're focused on today, he's explaining a new way of thinking when it comes to laying down the law that was laid down with Exodus, Leviticus, and Deuteronomy. So Reverend Dr. Allison Bowden was someone that we found online. He explained the history behind this particular scripture and what it would mean to the Jewish people as they heard it. So Bowden wrote, Jesus begins, "You have heard it said, eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth." And the Jewish listeners had heard that before. It's a quote directly from Leviticus. But the original law of restitution is actually one that's a humanitarian one. Jesus and those listening would have known that an eye for an eye means that revenge itself is limited. That the lost eye metaphor, if someone takes something from you, you don't take double back. So you wouldn't put out both eyes. But she translates it to say, if you have heard it said, do back to other people only what has done to you. Which is perfectly logical and absolutely in line with the Jewish teachings of the time. But I think that even that is difficult for us humans. If someone wrongs us, we don't hope that they get back just as much as they hurt us. You know, a lot of times we hope that they get hurt much worse, honestly. If someone cuts you off while driving down the road, you don't hope that someone else just cuts them off. No, you hope they get pulled over and they have to pay a fine for recklessly driving, and not because it means they're off the road, but because they cut you off. So Jesus goes on to say, but I say to you, do not resist an evildoer. And Bowden wants to know, is Jesus saying that we don't resist someone who wrongs us in the first place? That we just make ourselves completely vulnerable to them? That we don't resist harm at all? She doesn't think so, and neither do I. You know, the Greek word resist in the scripture is translated, and it actually means clash violently. So Bowden thinks that Jesus is saying, you have heard it said that do back to others only what's been done to you, but I say to you, do not clash violently with an evildoer. And that makes sense. I mean, if violence was done to you, do not do it in return, which is different than the law before Jesus started talking. It's a new direction, and as Jesus keeps talking, he's talking about turning the other cheek. So that goes right in line. And then in verse 41, Jesus says, and if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, then you should also go a second mile. So at the time, the Jewish people could be asked to carry the centurion's heavy backpack if the soldier didn't feel like carrying it that day. So the centurion would only be able to make them carry it for 1 mile. Now, do I have chosen fans here? We've talked to, okay. As I was going to say, this is a little bit of a spoiler alert. So if you haven't gone to the theaters and seen this, put your hands over your ears if you don't want to hear this part. But in the part that's in the theaters right now, they do this scene. And they include it where Jesus is walking with the disciples, and there's a group of centurion soldiers that stop them and make them carry their stuff for a mile. And they have to leave everything that they have. And they have to hope that it's there when they come back. And then they get to that 1 mile, and Jesus says, we're going for two. And when he does that, the centurion officers are bewildered. They're not sure what to do. They realize how their treatment of these Jewish people is affecting them. And it changes. So Jesus' lavish generosity changes the behavior of the centurion officers. The last part of the scripture says, to give to everyone who begs from you, and do not refuse anyone who wants to borrow from you. That is easier said than done, Jesus. I mean, a lot of us here have probably lent lawn equipment to someone. And when you hear the word borrow, we'd rather not, honestly. And I think in the case of most of these teachings, We'd rather not, and I am no exception. Back in January, I was in a parking lot near the Parks Mall, and I was walking my car when I noticed a woman who had a stroller, and it looked like she had packed everything that she had into that stroller, including the child. It was a cold day, and the child was covered in blankets, and I remember thinking, I remember those days when you leave the house and you have to make sure that you have everything you need. And then I looked a little bit closer, and I realized it was possible that that literally was everything that she had. And then I was frustrated with myself for making such a snap judgment, and so I smiled at her, and I kept walking to my car. And that's when she called out to me and asked if I had any money to give her. And I did not have any cash. I did not have any of our manna bags that we create, though I don't think at that moment that's what she needed. She had food, she had coats, she had blankets, but my brain was working overtime. Surely I had something, but I had nothing. And I told her that. I said, I'm so sorry, I don't have any cash. And I kept walking to my car. And then she called out, well, how about a hotel room? And I was right. She didn't need a manna bag. She needed shelter. And I stood there thinking, I used to work at a front desk at a hotel. You can't check in without a credit card. She needed a credit card to be put down to check into the hotel. And my immediate fear was that if I put my credit card down, she wouldn't have to leave the room, and then my credit card would be maxed out. And I couldn't afford to have my credit card be maxed out. So I'm standing there, my brain is just whirling, thinking of all these things, thinking of reasons, things that I couldn't do to help her. And so I finally just said back, I don't think so. And I'll never forget it. She repeated it back to me. She said, you don't think so. I said, no, I don't. And she said, okay. And she kept walking. And I kept walking. And I got in my car. And I sat there, and I'm still thinking, gosh, there's got to be something I can do. But in that moment, I couldn't come up with anything. And she passed behind my car, and she stopped for a minute, and she looked at my license plate. And I thought, that's weird. Why is she looking at my license plate? For a few seconds, she looked at it, and then she kept pushing her stroller with all her possessions towards Cooper Street. And then I realized the frame around my license plate is from our friend's car dealership. Sorry. And the motto that's written on the frame says, love God and love people. So she read those words, love God and love people. What message did I send to her? I had been given the opportunity to show God's love, and I felt like I failed. So I sat there in that parking spot, and I prayed to God. I asked God to watch over her for her child. I asked God to find shelter that I couldn't provide. I asked God to forgive me. I asked God to guide me and show me how I could help the next person that I meet in that same condition. I asked God to help me because when I was offered the opportunity to help someone to be the hands and feet of Jesus out in the world, I couldn't come up with a way to help them. I'm a pastor, and I couldn't come up with a way. Matthew 5:42 says, give to everyone who begs from you, and do not refuse anyone who wants to borrow from you. I prayed for guidance, and it wasn't too long after that God guided me. For those of you who don't know, I'm in seminary, and it is my last semester, praise God, and I'm taking a course called Congregational Care, and in that course, we took a field trip to Oaklawn United Methodist Church. Is anyone familiar with their ministries there? Okay, so I'm blown away by the ministries, but one particular thing that they do is they turn their basement into a homeless shelter when the temperature gets too cold or too hot. It's not a coincidence that I'm walking into those doors when I'm looking for guidance on how to be helpful to someone who is unsheltered. We discussed meeting people's needs and discussed that meeting someone's spiritual needs is just as important as meeting someone's basic needs. Praying with someone who is unsheltered is just as important as providing physical support. It's exactly what Jesus would do. Now, that woman in the parking lot, that's going to haunt me for a very long time. But for the future, I will be prepared because at the very minimum, I could have offered to pray with her. I'm not always standing in the parking lot with someone in need But this time I was, and I could have shown her that kindness. I could have talked to her about the love of Jesus. I could have called Arlington Life Shelter. I will be prepared next time, because you know there will be a next time. God is not done. And maybe next time, I'll be instead a little more like someone named Rashawn Dyah. Is anyone familiar with him? You're in for a treat. I stumbled across him on social media. He's an American TikTok star, Instagrammer, and social media influencer. And according to his Instagram page, he's got millions and millions of followers on both Facebook and TikTok. He's from New Jersey, and his Instagram page says, spreading love daily. So I was scrolling through Facebook as I came across one of his reels, and I don't know him, but I was very impressed with his content, and I feel that he embodies lavish generosity. So we're going to watch one of his videos. Spirit, lead me when my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Romans 12, 9 through 13 says, don't just pretend to love others. Really love them. Hate what is wrong. Hold tightly to what is good. Love each other with genuine affection and take delight in honoring each other. Never be lazy, but work hard and serve the Lord enthusiastically. Rejoice in our confident hope. Be patient in trouble and keep on praying, because when God's people are in need, be ready to help them. Always be eager to practice hospitality. These words from Paul are absolutely words to live by, but also hard to live up to. When faced with the opportunity to show lavish generosity, I hope we take a page from Rashawn Dyah. And when given the opportunity to show Christ's love out in the world, and you know you'll have that opportunity as soon as you walk out these doors, do not resist an evildoer. If anyone strikes you on the right cheek, turn the other also. If anyone wants to sue you and take your coat, give them your cloak as well. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, also go the second mile. Give to everyone who begs from you. Do not refuse anyone who wants to borrow from you. Be lavish in your generosity. Amen.
So Alyssa talked about how the Holy Spirit was working that day. Anybody else here have the Holy Spirit work within them? It worked on me a little bit this morning on the way in. I knew roughly what the message was going to be today, but God had to hit me upside the head with it several times on the way in. I was listening to the Christian radio station, playing one of those songs, you know, the one that's got 7 or 8 words and they just keep repeating over and over and over. Y'all have all heard that song. This one this morning told me to be a little more like Jesus and a little less like